Hello and welcome to Physiology Open. For this video, try to solve this question. In this question, there are two statements. First statement is an assertion and the second statement is the reason for the first statement. Now you have to choose from the following five options. You can pause the screen and think about the answer. By the end of the video, we will see whether you got the answer right or not. Let us see what are the classes of antiarrhythmic drugs. There are four classes of antiarrhythmic drugs depending on which channels or receptors they block. Class 1 drugs block sodium channels. Class 2 drugs are beta blockers. Class 3 drugs block potassium channels, while class 4 drugs are calcium channel blockers. Let us see what will be the effect of these drugs on action potential of cardiac pacemaker cells as well as contractile cells. See, this diagram is showing the action potential of both pacemaker cells as well as contractile cells. Pacemaker action potential has an automatic drift of resting membrane potential to the threshold, which occurs due to opening of HCN channels and T-type calcium channels, causing entry of sodium ions and calcium ions respectively into the cells. This is phase 4 of action potential of pacemaker cells. By contrast, you see in contractile cells, this phase 4 is constant, right? Now, phase of depolarization or phase 0 is due to entry of calcium in pacemaker cells, while it is due to entry of sodium in contractile cells. Phase of repolarization is due to exit of potassium from the cells in both contractile as well as pacemaker cells. In addition, contractile cells have this plateau phase, which is due to balance between entry of calcium and exit of potassium. Anyways, for the action of the antiarrhythmic drugs, we will not bring in this plateau phase again. So we will restrict ourselves to this phase 4, phase 0 of depolarization and phase 3 of repolarization. Also see the diagram of atrial action potential versus the diagram of action potential of ventricles. Now both are contractile cells, yet there is some difference in their action potentials. See, the duration of action potential of atrial cells is much less compared with that of ventricles. Tachyarrhythmias occur due to abnormality in either generation of action potentials or in conduction of impulse, or maybe both. In short, it can be addressed at the level of electrical activity in heart. So we should know first where on these action potentials different class of antiarrhythmic drugs will act. Sodium channel blockers, that is class 1 antiarrhythmic drugs, can block this phase in contractile cells. So due to this action, the threshold for phase 0 of action potential increases. Remember that at threshold, lot of sodium channels open. So if they are blocked, less channels will be available for opening. So threshold will increase. Also, it will decrease the slope of phase 0. It will not be this steep. So it will cause slowing of the depolarization. Note that they won't affect the action potential of pacemaker cells. It is being caused by calcium, right? So these sodium channel blockers will affect the contractile cells action potential. Class 2 drugs are beta blockers. They will act here on phase 4 of pacemaker action potential. Normally, sympathetic activity increases the slope. So if we block this sympathetic activity, phase 4 will become less steep, something like this, ultimately decreasing the number of impulses which are generated. Class 3 drugs, that is potassium channel blockers, will act here for both these action potential on phase 3. So, the potassium ions will not be able to go out of the cells. That is, it will take longer time for the membrane to repolarize. Thus, they will increase the duration of action potential and keep the cells refractory for longer time. Class 4 drugs, on other hand, act here in phase 0 of action potential of pacemaker cells. Remember, they occur due to entry of calcium ions through calcium channels, right? Now, these are L-type calcium channel blockers. So, they affect the phase 0, which is caused by opening of L-type calcium channels. Before we go further, we will talk little more about class 1 drugs. In class 1, there are 3 subclasses of drugs. See, there are different states of sodium channels, closed, open and inactivated. At resting membrane potential, they are closed. As depolarization occurs, they open and inactivate very fast. And as repolarization occurs, they again go back to closed state from inactivated state. So, class 1 drugs are further classified into subclasses on the state in which they block sodium channels and how long it takes the channels to recover once they are blocked. This is known as recovery time of the channels. Class 1A drugs block sodium channels in open state. Class 1B drugs block sodium channels in inactivated state. And we have seen that sodium channels become inactivated after opening once depolarization occurs. So these class 1B drugs are most effective on an already depolarized tissue, as seen in ischemia. Class 1C drugs block sodium channels in open state and also prolong the recovery time of these channels. So they will take long time to recover from the effect of the drugs. Plus, these class 1A drugs, they also have some effect on potassium channels. They also block potassium channels. So they have combined class 1 and class 3 activity. Okay, now let us see the logic of treating tachyarrhythmias which occur due to different mechanisms. Hopefully you know about the various mechanisms which lead to tachyarrhythmias. If not, you can check out the video given in the description section below. Well, we will recap a little the physiological basis of arrhythmias while discussing which class of drugs may be used for treating them. Tachyarrhythmias may occur either due to enhanced automaticity, triggered automaticity, or due to re-entry mechanisms. In arrhythmias, due to enhanced automaticity, the slope of the prepotential becomes steeper, maybe due to enhanced sympathetic activity, or the maximum diastolic potential, this maximum negative potential, becomes less negative so that it can reach to the threshold faster. So how can these kind of arrhythmias be treated? Basically, you will want to decrease the rate of generation of impulse. So that you can do either by decreasing the slope of this drift of phase 4, right? Increasing the threshold for excitation. So phase 0 will start much above than usual threshold. Or by prolonging the action potential duration. So as action potential duration prolongs, so automatically the number of impulses which will be generated will be less. Or maybe increasing the negativity of resting membrane potential, so that it takes more time to reach to the threshold. Because the voltage change which it will have to cover to reach to the threshold will be much more. So now apply the action of classes of antiarrhythmic drugs. First option can be achieved by beta blockers. Second option can be achieved by blocking calcium channels in pacemaker cells or by blocking sodium channels for contractile cells. Remember that automaticity is restricted to pacemaker cells. But sometimes in case of injury, contractile cells also may assume the automaticity. Third option, that is prolonging the action potential duration, can be achieved by potassium channel blockers. And fourth option, that is making the membrane more negative potential, can be done by acetylcholine and adenosine. Now these drugs are not given in any classes, but they can make the membrane potential more negative. Note one thing here, that in arrhythmias due to ectopic foci, where contractile cells have the automaticity, especially in case of ischemia, we need to block sodium channels. Class 1B drugs, which block the channels in inactivated state, are more useful for ventricular ectopic foci, especially in ischemic condition. Well, see, these are diagrams showing action potential of ventricles and atria. We have said earlier also that duration of action potential of atria is much less than that of the ventricles, right? That means in ventricles, the channels remain in inactivated state for longer time, right? As channels change their state, the drugs will dissociate from them. So the drugs will be active only till the time the channel is in that state. That means these drugs will be more effective for ventricular arrhythmias because in ventricular action potential, channels are in inactivated state for longer time. Class 1A drugs, on the other hand, are used for atrial fibrillation. Now let's come to second type of arrhythmias, that is arrhythmias due to triggered automaticity. These arrhythmias occur due to after depolarizations, which are seen either when action potential is prolonged, that is early after depolarization, or due to increased intracellular calcium load, that is delayed after depolarization. So logically, what will you want to do? First thing, do not allow these depolarizations to occur, right? Secondly, if they develop, do not allow upstroke of the action potential to happen. For preventing the development of early after depolarization, we need to shorten the action potential duration because these occur when action potential duration is prolonged. For this, increasing the heart rate by isoproterenol infusion is recommended. Again, we have not seen in the classes, but here in this video, we are talking about the strategy of treatment. So When we increase the heart rate, the duration of action potential decreases. For preventing the development of DADs, delayed after depolarization, we need to decrease the intracellular calcium load. That is, do not allow calcium ions to enter the cells. So now apply the action of classes of antiarrhythmic drugs. For this, we can use class 4 drugs, that is calcium channel blockers, since calcium is responsible for DADs. Or even class 2 drugs. Because generally, intracellular calcium load increases due to adrenergic stress. There exists a full mechanism by which adrenaline can cause increase in intracellular calcium. But that is not the subject of this video. For the second part, that is for preventing the upstroke of action potential, you can block sodium channels and increase the threshold for generation of action potential, right? So, class 1A drugs again may be used for this. Now, let's move to third type of arrhythmia. These are the ones which occur due to re-entry mechanisms. Re-entry of impulse may occur when it has two conducting pathways, but they differ electrically, with one pathway slower and the other pathway having fast conduction. And total time for the impulse to move around this re-entry circle has to be longer than the time for the cells to recover from previous refractory period. So if the impulse takes time T1 to reach these cells here, and the cells are refractory for time period T2, T1 should be greater than T2. Otherwise, the impulse will find the cells refractory and it cannot be propagated further. So, what can you do to treat this arrhythmia? Simple. Keep the cells refractory for longer time so that this T2 becomes greater than T1. Again, you put the drugs. Now, you have to use the drugs depending on the cells which are involved in the pathway. So, in case of ventricular cells, block sodium channels and prolong their recovery time. So, class 1C drugs may be used. We have seen that they also prolong the recovery time of the channels. Also, if you block potassium channels, it will prolong the duration of action potential, preventing it from getting repolarized. So, if the cells are not getting repolarized, sodium channels are in inactivated state, and this is responsible for the cells being refractory to any stimulus. If in the re-entry mechanisms, AV node conducting pathway is a part of this re-entry, we have to use class 4 drugs, calcium channel blockers, because sodium is not involved in their action potential, right? So, calcium channel blockers will prolong their refractoriness. Class 2 drugs also prolong AV nodal refractoriness. Now, let's come back to our original question. In this question, the reason statement is correct. We have seen that potassium channel blockers do prolong the duration of action potential since they will delay repolarization. Assertion statement is also correct here. In re-entry tachyarrhythmias, we want to prolong the duration of action potential so that cells are refractory for longer time, right? But also, if action potential is prolonged, it may lead to development of early after depolarization. Thus, these drugs, though are useful for one type of arrhythmias, predispose to other type of arrhythmias. So, in this case, answer is that both the statements are true. And indeed, R is the correct explanation for A. So, first option is the correct answer. In the next part in arrhythmia series, we will be discussing arrhythmia treatment from a different point of view. Okay, thank you for watching the video. If you like the video, please subscribe to the channel Physiology Open.